I'm Leilan from ESA Education. Did you know that astronauts on the International Space Station send photos from space to ground that you yourself can get at home using your computer, laptop, or smartphone connected to the internet? But what's so fun about downloading a photo from the internet? I hear you ask. Well, the International Space Station isn't actually on the internet. What? Astronauts on the space station use amateur radio to send these photos. So in order for you to actually get them, you have to listen to a particular radio frequency at a particular time when the space station is flying through the sky above you. You'll hear this sound for about 2 minutes. That's actually a picture, and you can use your computer to decode it and see what it is. Sound like fun now? Keep watching, and we're gonna show you how to get one step by step. Over to you, Dave.
Thanks, Leilan. So first we need to understand what amateur radio is. You'll be familiar with a domestic radio. You may have seen one built into a car, or you may have used a small battery operated one like this. These types of radio only use a very small amount of the available radio spectrum, what we call the commercial broadcast band. But there are many other radio frequencies used for all different kinds of purposes, like police, military, aircraft, the mobile phone network, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth are forms of radio that have their own special frequency in the spectrum. Parts of the spectrum are dedicated to a popular hobby called amateur radio, and these are special radio frequencies that can only be used for non-commercial conversations. You're not allowed to sell or advertise things. You can do technical experimentation, education, self-training, and emergency communication. And it's also used as a backup communication system for the International Space Station, and it's the only hobby governed by an international treaty. Now, to use amateur radio, you need a special type of radio, like this. A normal one that you might have at home can only receive the commercial broadcast band, so it's no use. To transmit amateur radio in most countries, you actually need to sit and pass an exam to get a license. But the good news for this activity, just receiving amateur radio is unlicensed. Anyone can do it. Yay! There is a type of website called a WebSDR.
Good luck on the calling frequency.
So to do this activity, all you need is a computer that's connected to the internet. Now there's an international volunteering organisation called ARIS. And what they do is they organise for schools all over the world to be able to talk to the astronauts on the International Space Station via amateur radio. And to do that, your school needs to make an application and go through a selection process, which takes some time. But as an additional activity, they also organise for the astronauts to transmit pictures via amateur radio for up to several days at a time. And when they do this, everyone everywhere can immediately get the pictures whenever the ISS is flying through the sky above them. Now to send the pictures, they use a technology called slow scan television. And I'll now hand over to my colleague Aengus, who will explain a bit more about what that is. Over to you, Aengus.
Thanks, Dave. Suppose your goal is to send a 3x3 picture, 9 pixels in total, showing a cross, for example, through a radio that was only ever meant to transmit and receive voice. You could just say white, black, white. New line, black, 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 new line, white, black, white, end. But that is very slow. If you want to make it faster for larger, more complex images, you could use short audible tones. So our 3x3 image might come out like E, oo, E, dit, oo, 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 dit, E, oo, E, da. It's easier for computers to understand tones of a particular frequency than what human voices are saying. This is the concept behind how SSTV works. Tone shifts up or down to give the pixel brightness and color. The transmission of a picture consists of horizontal lines of pixels scanned from left to right, converted into an audio tones by a computer program. The audio is fed into a radio and transmitted to other radios who feed the received audio back into the computer program to reconstruct the original picture. Note that this process is not digital. It's analog, so it can suffer from noise and interference, causing the pixels to come out wrong on the other end. It is common for the SSTV pictures to be received along with a bit of radio noise, which causes the loss of a few lines or whole parts of the picture. It may sound archaic, but this is how millions tuned in to watch humanity's first steps on the moon in 1969. While the technology has evolved, SSTV is still used on the International Space Station today. The ISS has a long history of transmitting SSTV pictures for global events, each lasting several days, where people the world over tune their radios to the ISS and try to receive some pictures every time it flies over their home. Typically, a picture is transmitted continuously for about 2 minutes, with 2 minutes of silence before the next picture starts. The ISS usually takes about 10 minutes to fly from horizon to horizon when it passes over your location. And so at that time, you can usually receive several images. It's important that you understand the behavior of the ISS orbit and why it only appears in the sky above you a few times a day. I'll hand you over to my colleague, John, who will explain why. All yours, John.
Thanks, Aengus. What's exciting about the ISS, apart from testing equipment bound for the Moon and Mars, is that it's flying 400 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. It circles the Earth every 90 minutes, so it orbits the Earth 16 times each day, and therefore the astronauts on board can see the sun rising 16 times a day also. The Earth's gravity is pulling the ISS towards it, but because the ISS is moving so fast above the surface of the Earth, it is in constant freefall. That's what gives everything on board the appearance of weightlessness. The time it takes to orbit the Earth, its period, is different to the time it takes the Earth to spin around once, so it doesn't remain over the same place. The low Earth orbit means that it will be below the horizon for most of the time, so it will only be visible for a few minutes, a few times each day. So how exactly does the ISS orbit the Earth? Well, the ISS orbits the Earth in an ever so slightly elliptical orbit. For all intents and purposes, you could say a circular orbit. The uppermost part of its orbit is 51.6 degrees north latitude, and the southernmost part of its orbit is 51.6 degrees south latitude. So, 51.6 degrees is its orbital inclination. If we take the globe to represent the Earth, and this laser light to represent the trace of the ISS as it orbits the Earth, it travels from 51.6 degrees north latitude, crosses the equator to 51.6 degrees south latitude. Because the Earth spins on its axis, making one full rotation every 24 hours, while the ISS revolves around the Earth at its own orbital inclination, the ISS doesn't pass over the same places on Earth during every orbit. In fact, because the ISS orbits the Earth 16 times each day, while the Earth spins from west to east below it, the ISS also orbits from west to east. Each new orbit is about 22 degrees to the west of the previous one. One full rotation of the Earth is 360 degrees in one full day, divided by 16 orbits of the ISS equals 22.5 degrees. The ISS doesn't have an ordinary phone number, so I can't Skype or WhatsApp the ISS. But the astronauts on board can phone home using special tracking satellites. They also use radio. The ISS transmits a radio signal as it orbits the Earth. The frequency of the received radio signal changes due to a phenomenon known as the Doppler effect. A common example of this is the change in pitch heard when a police car or an ambulance pass you by. The frequency at which the ISS transmits is 145.8 MHz, but this will appear to be up to 3.5 kHz higher in frequency as the ISS approaches you, and 3.5 kHz lower in frequency as the ISS moves away from you. The same thing happens with radio waves as with sound waves. Now, while I've been speaking, this Goonhilly Web SDR has been transmitting. Here is the signal coming in from the ISS, and it's passing through a virtual audio cable onto this RX SSTV. And here you can see the image projected onto the screen. The amount of retuning of the radio depends on the elevation of the ISS above the horizon. An overhead pass needs a lot of retuning because there's a large change in distance and relative speed as the ISS passes by. A low elevation pass, where the ISS just peaks above the horizon and dips back down again, needs very little. No Doppler shift compensation is performed on board the ISS itself. This must be handled by the individual ground stations, such as the Web SDR that you will be using. Don't worry, that's pretty easy to do. You can use the beautifully named Heavens Above website to track the trajectory of satellites like the ISS orbiting the Earth, so you know when to turn your radio on and to start looking for them. And now, Alberto will be happy to walk you through that.
Great. So you're ready to tune in with the ISS for some radio communications. However, you don't know if the ISS is above you or in the other side of the world. To make sure that the ISS is directly in your line of sight, you can do the following. Go to www.heavensabove.com or click on the link below. This will bring you to this page. First of all, you're gonna have to set up your location. So on the top right where it says location, click on unspecified. Now, because you will be using a web SDR such as this one, you're gonna have to set up the location of the web SDR itself, not your own location. So for example, I'm using this web SDR, Goonhilly Earth Station Cornwall. Now click on search. Great. You'll have to set up the time zone of your own time zone, not the one from this location. Now, because I'm in Ireland and it's the same time zone as the UK, I don't have to change this, but you'll have to change this to your own time zone or you will get the wrong times. Once you have set up the location and the time zone, click on update. It will bring you to the main page. Now, under satellites, click on ISS. Great. This is the page where you should see a table of when is the ISS visible in the sky. For this particular day, the ISS isn't visible. However, radio communications are also possible during the day. So click on all to see every single time that the ISS will be in the sky. Great. Now let's talk about this table. This is the column that tells you the date when the ISS will pass in the sky. Brightness, you don't need to worry about. These three columns will tell you the time frame when the ISS will be in the sky. So this is when it rises, this is when it sets, and this is when the ISS will be at its highest point. The alt column is the angle at which the ISS will be in the sky. So for example, 0 degrees means it's in the horizon, and 90 degrees means it's straight up above your head. The az or azimuth means the compass direction. So north, east, south, or west. Remember that if you want to see a sky chart of the path the ISS will be taking in the sky, you can just click on any of these rows. For example, let's click on this one. Now, what I usually do is I align north in this map, this one, with true north, right? And so once you have done that, you can project this map onto the sky. This is the path that the ISS will be taking in the sky. And this is the sun. So you can use the sun to guide yourself. At nighttime, you can use the constellations to guide yourself. It might also be useful to check the ground track. To do so, click on this link and check out this map. This map tells you gives you an idea of where the ISS is visible. It means it will be visible from this point to this point here. And the closer this path is from your location, the higher the ISS will be in the sky. That's it from me. I hope you've enjoyed this tutorial and are now capable of finding the ISS in the sky. The next step will be to choose an operating system from this list. One of my colleagues will walk you through this software setup.